So today I'll present you the work that we did on deformable force limiting floor diaphragm connection for earthquake resistant buildings. So in conventional buildings we have three main systems. We have the gravity load resistant system, we have the floor system that carries most of the seismic mass, and we have the lateral force resisting system. And the lateral force resisting system assumed to be rigidly connected with the floor system. Now, Robert Ivan Skinner in 1975 introduced this concept that he proposed to connect the tower with a moment frame using hysteretic dampers in order to dissipate seismic energy without introducing excessive interstory drift in the lateral force resisting system. Now, more recently, in 2004, Crane studied the influence of energy dissipation connections between floors and the lateral force resisting system using a small-scale building model on a shape table test. And she observed that we can have reduced floor acceleration in base moment at the wall. So, considering this work, my goal was to develop and evaluate a deformable connection that limits the earthquake-induced horizontal inertial forces transferred from the floors to the lateral force-resisting system of earthquake-resistant buildings. So, the first step was to create a physical embodiment for the force-limiting deformable connection. The next step was to assess the force-limiting deformable connection experimentally. We want to develop a design procedure and also validate this design procedure. So these are the four main objectives, and we are going to present all the steps. So the first was the physical embodiment. And initially, we need to take some time to explore what is this deformable connection and how it's implemented. So the first step is to create an opening in the floors around the lateral force resisting system. So here we show a reinforced concrete shear wall building. We create the opening around the wall, and we use deformable connections between the floors and the lateral force resisting system that consist of two components. The first component is the limited strength hysteretic component. And this ensures to transfer most of the lateral forces from the floors to the lateral force resisting system and provide stability to the gravity system. And then we use also bearing components in order to provide out-of-plane stability to the wall and also add some post-elastic stiffness to the deformable connection. Again, the goal is to limit the transfer forces by using this deformable connection. And thereby reduce the floor accelerations and force responses. We will show later that all this is related to higher mode responses. The first step in order to create this physical embodiment is to conduct a parametric numerical study using a 12-story reinforced concrete shear wall example building structure in order to identify the deformable connection approximate feasible design space. It's important to understand that this is the first time that someone is trying to do that, so we have no idea about the force level or the stiffness level that we need to use in these deformable connections. So the goal was to see what is the level of limiting strength in the deformable connection. Limiting strength meaning the force that we have the transition from the elastic to the post-elastic response of the deformable connection. Also, what's the elastic stiffness and what is the post-elastic stiffness? So we used this building model along with 18 ground motion from a FEMA P695 scaled to match the design spectrum, ASE 710 design spectrum, in the range of periods between 0.5 seconds to 2 seconds. Now, in order to identify which cases are working for us in terms of limiting strengths, stiffnesses, we explored a broad range of parameters. And this is shown graphically in this plot, where in x-axis we have the normalized limiting strength, with different colors we have the normalized elastic stiffness, and with different markers we have the post-elastic stiffness ratio. So, from this broad range of 420 combinations, and including always a case of rigid elastic connection, which basically represents the conventional building system, where we have a monolithic connection between a wall, let's say, and the floor, in order to make a direct comparison of the effectiveness of the deformable connection, we were able from this broad range to go to an approximate physically designed space. And how we did that? Well, the first step is to observe the connection deformations and try to eliminate all these cases that led to excessive connection deformations. We arbitrarily picked 100 millimeters as the limiting connection deformation, and we excluded all those cases that led to higher deformations. Also, we exclude those cases that seem difficult to design, meaning those cases that had very high strength but low stiffness, or very high stiffness and low strength. It's difficult to achieve something in the real world, something like that. So we excluded those. And for the same reason, we excluded all the cases that had very high stiffness, just because physically it was unrealistic. So we think this space, we can observe that by using a deformable connection and compared to the rigid elastic connection, we can reduce the floor accelerations by 50%. And that was a motivating result and helped us move forward and try to identify what are the physical components that can consist this deformable connection that are within this approximate physically designed space. So there are two configurations. The first configuration of the deformable connection consists of a buckling strength brace, which is the limited strength hysteretic component, and low damping rubber bearings that are the bearing components, provide out of plane stability of the wall and post-elastic stiffness of the connection. And the second configuration is consists of a friction device and low damping rubber bearings. And again, it's important to see this concept that we create those openings around the wall, the lateral force resisting system. We have nothing else to transfer the forces, and the only thing now is this connection. So to demonstrate this concept, I'll show you an example of a deformable connection installed in a half-scale, four-story precast opening shear wall structure that was tested at the University of California, San Diego. And here is shown a friction device connecting the floor with the lateral force resisting system. And bearing components, the low damping rubber bearings connecting the floor and the lateral force resisting system. This is a video that in the upper frames show the fourth floor friction device. You can see also two views of the building and the force deformation response of the friction device. It's interesting to notice the relative motion between the walls and the floors. I think it's impressive. So that actually shows that what we envision, it's actually realistic and we can implement it in real world. However, we wanted to understand more about the dynamic response of buildings with these connections. So we conducted a full-scale test here at Lehigh that I will talk more about them later, but an outcome from these experiments was the calibration of numerical models for these connections. That we were able to use them in this building model, the 12-story example wall structure that we presented earlier, along with the ground motions, the 18 ground motions that I talked about earlier, and make provide more input about the dynamic response of the building. So this plot is famous. You're going to see it a lot in this presentation. For this plot, we saw the connection force that is transferred from the floor to the lateral force resisting system. And you can see with different markers, we have buildings with rigid elastic connection, with friction device and rubber bearings, and buckling strength brace and rubber bearings. And we saw the peak values for the 18 ground motions at each floor. So for instance, if you pick one point, it represents the peak value at this floor for one ground motion. And if we take the mean value between the 18 ground motions, we can see this point here. So now some observations. We can see that when we have rigid elastic connections, these large mean peak values in the forces that we transfer from the floors to the lateral force resisting system are significantly reduced with the use of deformable connections. But even more important, this large dispersion that we observed in the results are tremendously reduced with the use of the deformable deformable connection. Now, if we focus on the 12th floor, we can see that we have a reduction of the mean peak value about 7% and a reduction of standard deviation about 95%. Now, in terms of floor total accelerations, we can see similar results, where when we use the deformable connections, we achieve a more uniform distribution of floor total accelerations, which are approximately equal to the mean peak ground acceleration. In terms of lateral force resisting system story shears, we can see that these large mean peak values in the story shears are significantly reduced again. And focusing on the base shear, we see that the mean peak values are reduced by 45% and the dispersion is reduced by 85%. So I think that's significant, because thinking that we can reduce the dispersion of the force response and acceleration responses that much means that we can design the lateral force resisting systems in earthquake resistant buildings more reliably. And I think that's important. Now, the trade-off is that we allow some deformation to occur at its floor level, right? So we can see that for this design, the floor deformation, the connection deformation, is not excessive. And also the drift that we observe is not excessive. So if you compare the building with rigid elastic connections with the cases that we use deformable connections, we have pretty much the same drift. So we don't introduce more demand in the gravity system. Right. We'll talk more about this. It's not everything perfect. So, but there is a question here: why all these reductions are happening? What is going on